Okie dokie.
Good. And I've already received comments from a couple of you. Thank you. And so we have no structure tonight, just looking at the policies. So feel free.
I have a dumb question about formatting in the beginning. The way this is set up is you've compiled the issues and opportunities prior to this in the document. And then here we're repeating each of the issues and then setting policies underneath. So this is now an issues and policies section rather than a goals and policies section.
That's right.
All right, so we're doing away with goal statements completely?
Back at the first workshop, we looked at the goals, and those came first. Those are 10 broader statements. And then each goal has a category that goes with it. There's an economic development goal, an education goal, community wellness, etc. And then each of the group of issues falls within those categories.
Right, and we were assigning the issues to different categories, and some of them we thought needed to repeat or be re-mentioned or possibly in a different wording.
Right. Okay. So if you look at things as being like categorized, it's like we have policies that fit within an issue each. We have each policy, I'm not explaining it very well, but each policy yet goes within its issue box, and each issue goes within its goal box.
Right, or category goes right.
Yeah.
Okay.
So to follow on with that, in one of the sections, I mailed this in, I thought that there were a lot of opportunities that we weren't maybe taking advantage of putting in natural resources. I thought that several of the opportunities should be written as policies. The reestablishment of a green space program to establish a connected network of green space and parkland through programs such as Rails to Trails. I thought that should be a policy. You know, we should take advantage of that opportunity and say that we wanted to do it. To develop a Canopy Road program to provide protection of natural resources and include increased tourism opportunities. That's a opportunity that we want to take advantage of. That there were a whole bunch in that section particularly that I thought the opportunities could also be written as policies.
That's a question I have to follow up on. Why don't the opportunities have policies as well?
Where the policies come from is they come from the prior adopted comprehensive plan, and the way it works when I put all this together is I've got my issues right that come out of our prior workshops where we talk about the issues, and I find policies to fit with the issues. So I look at each issue and say what are the policies that fit with that. So I looked in the prior Lowndes County Comp Plan, and for most of the issues I found a policy that fit. And for ones where I didn't find one there, I looked into the common community vision and found something there that fit. And that way, the statements that we start with here are all being drawn from an existing adopted planning document rather than just, I'm not just making them up. So that's the story on that. That's where they come from.
So I guess what happened to the opportunities then?
This workshop now, and before this workshop, people's opportunity to comment on the policies that I send out. That's the point where the community gets a chance to look at the opportunities and say, "Hey, these opportunities need to be policies," which is exactly what you did for us. So,
okay, so I have to take confess that while I was working on this afternoon, because I'm my procrastinator. I'm so sorry. But it wasn't until I got to natural resources where I'm thinking, hey, wait a minute, we thought of a whole bunch of good stuff that we should be doing and that those are our opportunities. And I was specifically thinking about it in Rails to Trails. And I think that John maybe commented on that too about Rails to Trails, that that's a you know, if we're wanting to do healthy lifestyles and we're wanting to provide these, you know, green spaces that are connected to people, we need to have a policy about that we want to try to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And then I found it in opportunities is where I found that, to say let's include that.
Great. I think as the planner who's compiling everything and facilitating the workshops, it's not really my place to pick and choose which opportunities turn into policies, but if you all want to, essentially if you all want to tell me what to do, I can do it if you don't.
Describe, right. So what happened to the opportunities that did not become policies, or did not get translated to policies?
For now, they're just still in the opportunities section, but
okay.
If you wanted, you could check off on the list which opportunities you all think should become policies and give them to me.
Sure.
All right,
so that's still its own section. Now, my category goal statements, economic development, education, and so forth, that's still back in that earlier section.
Mm-hmm. Right, yes.
All right, my question is, and here's where I'm kind of going down to it, wouldn't it be a good idea to repeat those in this part too, since the policies are here?
The categories are repeated.
The categories are, but it's just the header of economic development, so the economic development goals are not listed.
To repeat the goal header
the policies then link to the goal statements.
So they make sense. Why are we doing this? Because it meets this goal.
Exactly.
I understand.
Absolutely, yes. So when we have community policies, we have economic development. Right here, we restate our economic development goal, and the same for all the sections. Yes, I will do that.
I think that would be helpful to have it in one spot.
Great. Yeah, that's a good idea. I should have come.
Well, I might go back and read again the opportunities and check off to say, hey, in economic development, we want to make sure that this opportunity that we talked about gets into the policies.
Right.
Lots of them are just repeated over and over, and you're like, oh, that's such an awesome thing. We want to encourage, coordinate, blah, blah, blah. We say the same thing over and over in every section.
Right.
Like, great. We know that we're doing that thing. But there's some things that I think that we've talked about.
All right. And then there's some things in there we need to keep in mind that are specific tasks to do, like projects to do, that really aren't policies, but are actually work items for the short-term work program.
Right.
So we've got to
keep those
carrying along
until
we get into that other chart.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm curious, this is getting ahead, but schedule-wise, when do we want to talk about those? I know you guys are going to walk around and have one-on-one meetings with each of the six governments.
Right.
Any idea when those are happening, since
I think they're
sometime later in June, or?
I think we're aiming to have them later in June, yeah. Would that work well from your perspective?
Yeah, it would. I was just wondering, and then so then the final public hearing to transmit as a draft would then be in July?
I believe so, yeah. I think that's what we're aiming for. Or possibly August. The deadline's October.
Yeah, we got to give DCA 60 days, and then our local governments, we've got most of the small ones only meet once a month. Early October.
Right. DCA only requires.
Meeting.
Oh, sorry. DCA only requires 30 days, actually.
30 now.
Yeah.
That's a switch.
Okay.
30 days is more doable then.
Yeah.
Okay, so sometime in August to sometime in September still works.
Absolutely, yeah, for the final adoption.
Is DCA keeping to the 30 days?
They've been very good about it, yeah.
Okay. Good.
But so, yeah, July is good to aim for transmittal of the draft to DCA. It's good to aim for, it's just nice to preserve some wiggle room for ourselves,
mm-hmm.
depending on how things go.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, one thing I could do is print real quick the issues and opportunities section for everyone, and we can just quickly check off what opportunities we want to move to the policies, or perhaps I don't know, what do you all think is best?
I would have grabbed the wrong notebook on the way out of my office. So I won't have a notebook. I mean, I'm fine, I can sort of imagine what some of these statements are anyway, but
some of the opportunities, of course, are already covered in the policies, like there are policy statements that cover some of the opportunities. If you all wanted, I could go through the opportunities, and if any opportunity isn't already covered in the policies, I could make sure it is. But I don't know if you want to take that kind of blanket approach. You might want to more pick and choose opportunities that become policies. In any case, after this workshop, I can send out the policies section again with the revisions I've received by email and the revisions from tonight, and you all can send me some final revisions.
And when you send it out, is there a way that in a header or a footer you can put like a print date or something?
Oh, yes.
Just so we come across it later, we know which version we're looking at.
Mm-hmm.
Help me anyway.
Yeah.
So you have the printer from the beginning of time, so I try not to ever print anything out if I can answer
it. I was curious about that.
That's
amazing. I don't know how.
I haven't seen printing like this in a long time.
Yeah, I'm amazed that it has held up this long.
One that you hope that never breaks, which you'll never get parts for.
Right.
I may be far ahead of everybody else, but I'm looking at page 49, item 6. One of the things here talks about development in the upper part of our watershed, which really isn't necessarily Lowndes County.
I think it was meant not to be Lowndes County.
Well, one of the things here is it talks about using and these policies, those policies don't address that at all. Because we have no, Lowndes County has no control over site design in another community. I think that might be more of an education policy rather than site design. Maybe that education is education of good site design. It needs to be reworded, I think, so that it's, because we have no control over that.
There's two parts to that, I think. There's, in our own community, we need to use innovative site design to make sure that we're not making the problem worse for downstream. For downstream.
Mm-hmm.
And then as a second policy, to educate our neighbors upstream about things that they could do, even though they're maybe not mandated, but you know, that there might be things that they could do that could help us all who are downstream.
This phase two,
To, you know, just add a second piece.
Mm-hmm.
I think that on a lot of education, there can be education component on lots of these where people just don't know. They don't know what Parks and Rec things are available to them, or they don't know where to go for something.
Sure. Educate our neighbors upstream about things they can do to reduce flooding and other problems associated with impervious surfaces.
Or even say work together as a community with our upstream neighbors. You know, we're going to work together as a region. On item number, it's not this email, but it's not the suggestion. 216, which is on page 41.
Mm-hmm.
School culture or focus on sports over books. And the policy is the same as the policy in 210, which is lack of accountability for parental involvement. And I don't necessarily think that the same policy works for both those things.
So I had this
same
thing.
It shouldn't repeat the same policy like that.
It maybe could be similar, but I think the item 216 needs to be more around books.
Right, so there needs to be something to say that, you know, that there's equal or more value in academics than there are in sports.
Mm-hmm.
I understand sometimes why a policy can fit in more than one place, but I didn't think that that was one of the places where the same policy fit.
Mm-hmm.
That 216 needs to be. And read us our goals for education. Can you read us the goals for education?
Yes. It's through advanced training and community support, prepare students for high-skilled, high-wage careers.
Okay, so in 216, I might change, I like the beginning of that a lot, by creating an environment of ownership, stewardship, and responsibility. But then to change the end of that because I have the actual comment, the word I want to use got away from me. The thing I wanted to say is academic achievement, that rewards academic achievement or something like that, recognizes academic achievement.
Keep it the same by creating an environment that recognizes and rewards academic achievement.
Yes. You know, kids see big rewards for being on the sports team. They should No, we're begging for money in the Valdosta schools to send the debate team on a competition. That shouldn't be.
I would change it even further, so by creating environments that reward. Because in the different settings, you can have different environments.
Right.
And you know, part of this too is, I mean, it's a conference plan, it's really for the local governments. It's, you know, the school boards do not sign on to this.
Right. But as a community,
it's a statement that we make. And
well, right, and if we get, you know, more community members saying, you know, the debate team is important, you know, maybe that would make a difference.
Good. Cultivate an atmosphere of student excellence and high academic performance by creating an environment that recognizes and rewards academic achievement.
Well, that was one where I had just said something different, so that we actually made progress on. Okay, so in 2019, the problem is educational millage rates are coming close to the maximum allowed. This policy doesn't address that at all. Mm-hmm. Encourage and coordinate public-private partnerships between workforce training agencies, counties, blah, blah, blah. That doesn't have anything to do with the millage rate. And there's not really anything to do about the millage rate, save for raise the assessments of everybody's, you know, raise the appraisal, then everybody's worth more, so you don't have to tax them as much. Then you can tax them more later. I mean, that's sort of the whole little game we get into, right? But I don't know a good policy about millage.
The policy might be to encourage wise spending of
good stewardship,
educational tax dollars. And that's very broad, but that's this down to the revenues, that revenue source.
That's a finite revenue source.
Mm-hmm. Encourage good stewardship of educational tax dollars.
All right, Aaron, back on the formatting topic. This is something that, well, it didn't stick out to me before, but it stuck out to me now. DCA, I mean, wants us to list the issues with the policies in the plan document rather than a separate thing like we used to do. In terms of numbering,
the numbering is crazy, isn't it?
Well, I think we need to fix it. It doesn't leave any room for amendment in the future, okay? So I think adding a decimal place helps. So for example, on page 38, economic development, without being labeled as section one, we're sort of listing it as section one. Okay. So everything under economic development starts with a one. And then issue one means it's 1.1. And the first policy under issue one would be 1.1.1.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So 1.1's 1, 2, and 3. And then the next under number two will be 1.2, 1, 2.
Yeah, 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 that would be much.
So then as we go forward through time, as we amend these, take some out, add more in, we don't have to renumber the whole dang section. We can just renumber that paragraph grouping of policy.
Right.
That would help us
long
term.
Yeah, well, John and I were talking about the numbering of this. We're like, if I want to stick one in a section, then all the sections beyond that
Good, okay.
So I mean, what I would like to do is get, since it's sort of a reformat change from the prior version, is just get a version that we can go forward with, keep it a living document, review the thing every year, tweak it as we go along, which means we don't have to have it perfect coming out of the chute, but as close as reasonable, and then plan on amending this next summer.
Right. Okay.
Thank you.
I'm.
Yeah, I'll fix those numbers, as you suggested, with the issues will be like 1.1, 1.2, and the policies will have three.
It's going to start looking like the ULDC.
Well, nothing wrong with that.
Point A.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think three numbers with decimals is plenty.
Yeah, that makes it easier to add things, yeah, definitely.
I wanted to comment on page 44, this is under the community wellness section. Items 9 and 10, to me those policies don't address either one of those issues. Because we're saying for lack of health specialists, continue to provide high quality.
Right, I wrote it.
Well, if we have, if we're going to continue to provide it, why is that
why is it now an issue?
I wrote on mine that I read in, the policy doesn't address the concern. Consider adding, investigate and explore work with whatever, however you start the sentence, to attain necessary resources for a trauma center, work to resolve any areas of deficiency.
I think that's appropriate. I'll prefer to.
Or identify, you know, areas of deficiency. So that we know what it is that we have to do, and we know what we have to do. We have a trauma center. We need to have a neurologist on staff 24 hours a day. That's the thing we're missing. A neurosurgeon, somebody, if you're in the rec, I can help you. You don't have to fly away.
We've got some in the community, they're just not
we don't have
in the right spot.
We don't have the coverage that we need. We need like another one. And then we maybe need a special operating room where they can do that special, you know, if there's some tools they need or something for that kind of thing. But yeah, I wrote that into it.
I would say page 44, item 12. 3.28.
That's
same
one.
Same.
Get rid of that.
Well, I think what we're trying to say is we need to stress academic achievement in teenagers. That's not what that says.
Right. To help the students understand why it's important to achieve. I also added in there that there needs to we provide access to family planning resources.
That's what needs to be said.
That they need to understand what family planning means. You know, plan.
Jumping ahead, page 47, 5.5. I would just insert a word in there. The urban service area shall be annually reviewed and updated to ensure.
This is more of a general comment throughout. I just found an acronym, but I don't have a clue what it is. A CIPS.
Oh, where is
this page 43, item 3.8.
I guess that was community planning something I didn't know.
But it might, one thing I was going to say since
capital improvement programs. Yeah, but I'll spell it out.
It's one thing since a lot of times you'll be referencing this document. You know, if I'm going to look at the transportation section, I'm going to look at the transportation section. I'm not going to look at every other section. Even instead of using acronyms, you may want to spell it out every single time. And you put the acronym in, that's fine.
In parentheses.
You know, I'm not going to be looking for it on 20 other pages trying to remember what that is. But that might be throughout. That was just one I saw. So,
I'll general note. Yeah, that's good.
I'll check throughout and spell out any acronyms that could be at all mysterious to anyone.
Okay, at the top of page 45, you have 3.32. That can be applied to issue number 12 on the previous page.
Oh.
That will just kind of hit or miss.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
There.
Yep.
That just seems to fit that issue as well.
Oh, yeah.
Good catch.
In issue policy 519, the sentence doesn't make sense, and the same sentence was used somewhere else. Joint comprehensive importance of planning efforts and resulting documentation shall be appreciated and employed as a vital tool. You can be appreciated or employed, but probably we don't appreciate and employ something. I don't know. I don't know what that wants to say, but.
That really doesn't pertain to every witness.
If you strike out the appreciated, it makes more sense.
But does it apply to overlay districts?
No. I had trouble finding any policies in existing documents that apply to that overlay district issue, so it could be a missing new one.
Districts is I think that people don't understand why they exist. So it might be an education issue to educate people why we have overlay districts and why we do different things out in some streets or some areas than we do in other areas.
So an educational language in place of 519.
Mm-hmm. So just something as simple as educate people as to why we have overlay districts?
Well, and you know, how it works to their benefit. I mean, the benefits of overlay districts.
I was trying to say the importance of overlay districts.
Mm-hmm. The importance and benefit of,
Right. Because they're not as restrictive as the, in my opinion, they're not as restrictive as they're helpful.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I know people that have but it's really not that.
They don't understand what
exactly.
They think it's some horrible thing, and it may very well not be. We've got some overlay districts that actually grant special approvals and favors that you otherwise wouldn't be entitled to.
Mm-hmm. Educate people as to the importance of overlay districts.
Importance and benefits.
Importance and benefits of overlay districts.
Jumping ahead to housing.
What page is that?
It's 45.
Oh, yeah, we're behind me. The men's shelter, the 24-hour men's shelter is needed. The policy doesn't address that problem.
Oh, yeah, on page 47, it's one of the last issues.
I had a question under housing as well. Page 45, items 4.5 and 4.6.
Mm-hmm.
We're asking that we should analyze the impediments and barriers to affordable housing, at least within the city of Abasta. That's already done. They have to do that. So that might need to be reworded. Again, that applies only to one of our jurisdictions, but.
Right. That's another issue. Maybe we should hammer out a policy for the men's homeless shelter issue, and before we come back to that, just so we don't just so that doesn't get forgotten. But and then we'll jump back to that that affordable housing issue.
Right, because I think that we saw this policy before under some other section. And it just got recycled here, but it doesn't it doesn't address it.
Yeah.
I don't know what the policy should be. I mean, what's a government policy that would
you could say promote nonprofit and faith-based organizations that provide those services.
Okay.
keep like a database as some ways.
Well, teach them to know what resources are available, because lots of people that are homeless, they have some other problem. You know, they have a mental health issue, or they have...
Well, I would say that might be to where they can get shelter, but then that second, the policy that's there maybe point you in that direction of what those other underlying problems might be. I think you need one statement to at least get the shelter issue.
Okay, well, so we have a policy that's somewhere else that we've seen several times that says... work with nonprofits and stuff, and even search engine.
I know the one you're.
You know the one.
Probably find it.
Well, there's one that says existing nonprofit community resources shall be utilized where possible to address community wellness issues and opportunities.
That could be reworded to address, community nonprofit, blah, 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 could be used to encourage.
It could just say to address homelessness.
The one we have there is not the
one.
Right.
Okay. I may be way off base here. It's quite possible. But if we're saying a 24-hour men's homeless shelter is needed, do we need to target the men, or do we need to target somebody that's going to supply the shelter?
Are there more available 24-hour shelter facilities for homeless women?
Yes, there are 24-hour homeless shelter facilities for women.
So that means net for women, yeah, so I think that's where it came from.
Well, so your question is, who needs to solve the problem? Do we need to solve the problem for a homeless shelter, for shelter, or do we need to solve the problem to get men help?
Yes.
We need to solve both those problems. We need to get men help so that they're not homeless.
To me, it doesn't sound that's the way it's written. To me, number 13 sounds like somebody needs to build a building for men. And then you're going to follow it up with, oh, we're going to give these men this information. Am I totally off base on that? Is that where you read that?
It reads to me a 24-hour men's homeless shelter is needed, except we need a building.
Yes, we need a building.
Right. That's how that reads to me, is we need a building.
Okay.
But that's maybe not the problem that we're really trying to solve.
Right. That's right. So
The fact that we need a men's homeless shelter is a symptom of the problem that we have.
That's right. That's what I said. That's it. Thank you, ma'am. But I don't know if it's it. So.
Well, we have this issue that somebody thinks we need a men's shelter. We do need a men's shelter because we have men, we have problems that need resolution. And in the meantime, they don't have a place to stay. So they can't help.
They make it like separate items.
Can we add?
Or either add.
The new numbering system we can add.
Well, because do we have some more mental health issue, a general mental health issue that we need better mental health support in the healthy things?
I think we do. Let me find that. Yeah.
It's gotten to be so many sections and so many issues and so many opportunities that you can't hold them all in the brain.
A lot of material. Okay, I'm looking at community wellness. I swear there isn't. There wasn't mental health.
Community wellness. If it had section number on it, we could easily
take break
it. Okay, I'll take it.
No, there's an issue under education, lack of school options for those who suffer from mental illnesses. That's what I was remembering, but. because that's just an education. And of course, we're allowed to go back and change the issues too.
I think it could be just, you know, simple. 24-hour men's homeless shelter is needed to be better advertised, to be better accessible, to be
more accessible.
We don't
have
one.
At
all?
No.
We don't have one at all.
No. We don't have one at all.
And it's a non-profit that runs one of Haven.
The One for the Women, yeah, it's a non-profit.
Yeah.
But there's not a place where men can sleep at the Salvation Army, but they can't stay there. They can sleep over there, but then they have to go out and do whatever it is that they do. It's not shelter. And if you're a man that's in a situation, I mean, there's abused men, say this is abused women. There's not a place for them to go and seek shelter.
There have been some cities that have had successful innovative programs to address homelessness, and I remember it came up when we were discussing the education section. The Kalamazoo Promise was mentioned. That was a program in Kalamazoo, Michigan, that was an education program. So I wonder if similarly,
we listed that as an opportunity, the Kalamazoo Project.
Oh yeah, that's right. So I wonder if there.
So we need to write that as a policy that we want to do something like that.
Oh yeah, and I didn't mean to bring us off topic, but I mean there could be some program that some other city has had to address homelessness.
Well,
and
in
Salt Lake City, I think, has done.
Utah doesn't have homelessness anymore because they gave everybody house, and then that helped them with their health issues too, because everybody got well once they were sleeping indoors. So they solved a lot of problems by making sure that everybody had a place to live, even if it was tiny. Mm-hmm. So,
I mean,
I'm still really liking this, that we're talking about this sort of a big thing, because then we can, you know, we looked at each section in its own without talking about the other sections that it was really wrong to.
So, I mean, a potential policy could be something like investigate innovative methods to address homelessness if you want to write something really broad.
Yes, and then it's not just for men, it's for all homelessness.
Okay, well, let me take a step.
Have chat for humanity here.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that's,
you know,
right.
And Austin has a tiny house village now, where they have little mini houses, and they have a garden for the people who live in the mini houses. They could have a community garden there, and then they have a community center, so there's like a bigger room, so if they want to have meet with family, because their mini house is just like a little kitchenette and a sleeping compartment. But they have made big strides in Austin in terms of solving their homeless problem, just a little mini house community. So other communities are making progress, and yeah, we have a homeless problem here because we have great weather and you can stay outside. People come here because weather is mild, but we don't have huge number of homeless people. I think it is something.
So, just taking a stab at writing a policy. So, like, how about this? Investigate innovative programs that have been used in other communities to successfully address homelessness, and assess whether they could be applied here. Something like that.
See, that to me sounds like a work on rather than a policy.
Yes, okay. We need to word it a little more like policy. Just need to.
Okay, you want to offer a wording on that? What would be a policy on that? Investigate innovative.
I wouldn't start it with the verb. That makes the work on it. So, innovative. Make a statement, you know, shall be encouraged.
Okay.
Made of concepts or comparison. Let's see. Read what you had written again.
What I had written?
Yeah.
Okay. Investigate innovative programs that have been used in other communities to successfully address homelessness and assess whether they could be used here.
Shorten it, but I mean, innovative concepts and programs to address homelessness
shall be considered
or shall be investigated.
Yeah.
In- innovative programs and concepts to address homelessness shall be investigated.
Shall be promoted.
Shall be promoted.
Because then when we're talking about zoning, you say, well, we're going to have this innovative thing. Let's make sure that we have zoning that accommodates
that. Well, we're doing the zoning case for the plan development with the small houses.
Right.
We've got a policy to attach to.
Right.
Okay. Innovative concepts and programs to address homelessness shall be promoted. Okay.
That's part of it too, all through here. Sometimes we shall, sometimes we don't.
I like it when we use shall.
Yeah, I know, it's strong. But usually for policies, you see shoulds rather than shalls. Mm-hmm. You know, but depends on how strongly you want to word it.
Just when we started talking about this issue, I also wrote down encourage nonprofit and faith-based organizations to provide 24-hour shelter services, because someone said that. You want to keep that too?
Yes.
Okay, good. I want to come back to housing issues 4.5 and 4.6 on page 45, because Corey was starting to say something about that, and don't want us to forget about that. There was that specific issue number two, the disconnect between where affordable housing is built and where it's needed, and we may need a specific new policy to address that.
But on a broader topic, let's make sure I'm clear. The housing section, the element, is triggered because of Al Oster.
That's right, yeah.
But so we include a housing section in the community policies, which applies to all six local governments,
mm-hmm.
which is fine. I think that's good. In my opinion, housing needs to be addressed countywide,
right.
Not just Al Oster. Which means, and all through here, we've got some items that are worded specifically as if this were Valdosta only. And we need to broaden some of that.
Mm-hmm.
And this being sort of an example.
Well, but the thing is, this sentence, though, really, you said Valdosta has already analyzed the impediments. Okay, so
Valdosta has, but the other communities.
Right, right, but they haven't. But analyze the impediments and barriers to affordable housing and implement steps to alleviate these impediments. Okay, well, so this other communities do the analyze the impediments and barriers, and Valdosta does the implement. I mean, that still works.
Well, then you and those other communities should be doing implementation if they're going to help.
On their own.
So, yeah.
Right.
But I think that sentence can apply to both.
Yeah. But when after that discussion, I agree.
Yeah, but in the 4.5, we need to reword it, though, so it sounds a little bit like 4.4. I mean, don't start with a verb again. Analysis of impediments and barriers to affordable housing. Okay. To implement steps to alleviate these impediments.
So we want to just switch it around to something more passive voice, basically, like impediments and barriers to affordable housing
shall be
analyzed, and steps to alleviate those shall be implemented, especially in...
Right.
There you go.
Okay,
right.
Got it.
There you go.
Okay, so now I want to stick in housing and go to number 14. Clearing the title on an abandoned property takes over a year and therefore delays revitalization. But the policy doesn't address that issue. The existing housing stock shall be proactively protected and maintained, utilized, and public private properties. But it doesn't. There needs to be some other policy for, and I don't know if there is some, like, does Georgia statute say you have to do these steps to clear the title on something, so you're stuck in a 180-day or 3-year or whatever it is? So maybe there's nothing that we can do to make it faster.
It is a state law issue, actually, and Ware County, the same issue came up in Ware County's comp plan. They have problems with that, too, because properties sit abandoned. And I can pull the policy that they wrote for theirs if you want to see it, but it was basically something like investigate possibilities for how to address this issue.
So you're saying it's going to take a year regardless? It's like a 365-day process in the story?
Yeah. Right.
Because the state law requires that you have to do, so would the policy would maybe be to lobby the legislature to change?
Well, yeah, but I mean, that's an action item too. It really, I really question why that's in here, you know, for something that's way beyond.
Right, well, and.
We can strike the issue if you guys think that's best.
Do we know how it got in here? Did it get in because of the community vision where they could freeform write whatever they wanted?
It didn't get edited out when we went through the issues last.
Yeah, I would pitch it myself.
Okay. But I was going to say, this might, I think this is maybe more about a land bank authority issue.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And maybe it needs to be reworded. Mm-hmm. Because I think that's where it comes from. It's the land bank authority is where this comes from. You know, now there are companies out there that all that they do is clear title on abandoned property for land banks. That's all the companies do.
Okay.
So I think that this might be worth keeping, but it needs, I don't necessarily have a good answer at this moment.
It needs some serious
redoing or rolled into something else.
Rolled into a land bank.
Is there a land? Is there another one that talks about land banks somewhere else in the document? Or?
And you
don't necessarily have to have an answer for that right now. But
right. It's,
okay, so if we could write a policy that says, you know, the land bank shall use available services to clear title or something. Wouldn't it? If we could put homeless people onto these hunks of property that nobody's claiming.
That would be an
innovative
concept.
Yes, it would.
Place them there until such time as.
Yeah.
they could mow the grass once there.
Yeah.
Comes with a
lawnmower. Yeah.
So if you could make a policy, it'd be something about land bank.
Okay.
The land bank.
Sounds good, yes.
Okay, sentence 7.6 was new to review. Did you think about that one already?
Cultural resources.
Page 51.
Oh yeah, that's kind of a capital.
There's just a random
C
in the middle of that.
Develop and maintain and improve the something.
T.
Okay.
One of the things that I commented on this one, lack of museums such as the Science Museum, this statement has nothing to do with science.
Right.
So it might be more either say lack of museums, period, as the issue, or if it's science museum, those policies need to be.
Needs to say how are we going to get the science museum?
Yeah.
Or how are we going to encourage science in the schools or something? Yeah.
Could be better to just go with the reword the issue slightly to make it broader, just lack of museums.
And you might be able to include examples, science.
Like i.e. science.
And a couple of others.
Okay,
but
what else? Children's Museum.
Children's
Museum is one that people come by later, the Children's Museum. Well, we have a wonderful
aquarium.
Art museum.
What is that? What's the marine sun?
We may have a science museum coming.
Oh, yeah?
You know, we had a first step meeting with a local family.
Awesome.
It's one to create one. Pretty nifty one.
Cool.
That's cool. Right.
So what should we do with this here? Should we?
I think recreating or restating the issue to make it science museum as an example.
Science and children's museum could be examples.
And then maybe an et cetera.
Then the policy maybe works okay.
Yeah.
Once you remove the T that's in the middle of it.
Right, all of that. So just lack of museums, like you said, e.g. Science Museum or Children's Museum.
Okay. Okay, well, wait a minute now. Is going advanced thing, develop, maintain, and improve our actions, they're not a policy.
Yeah, no, it's an action statement. So I was, I mean, that kind of thinking needs to be applied all the way through here.
But for
7.6, I would start it as cultural facilities such as, okay.
Shall be developed, maintained, and improved.
Do you all think I should go through the entire, all the policies and...
Yeah, all the statements need to read like policies.
Passive voice, X shall be blank and
right.
Blank.
And yes. A good number already are, it's just not all.
Yes. I'll go through it all and make sure they're reworded that way.
Yeah. I mean, it doesn't change the content
just,
of what's there, it just
right, exactly.
Flips the sentence around.
Just changes
it.
Well, and then everybody knows what's the policy, not what's an action that we're going to take, but the policy is that we're going to do this thing.
Yeah, the policy is that these are things that need to be.
Right.
Okay. Okay, I will do that.
Sorry, we just made your job.
Yeah, that's just putting it in plenary ease.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, so item number 7, I didn't comment on this, but I will now. Proliferation of billboards on I-75 impacts the aesthetic quality of the community. It is recognized that designing and structure of residential and non-residential streets contributes to the overall character and development patterns of the community, and thus shall be considered one of the most important components. It has nothing to do with
billboards. Right.
Nothing to do with billboards. So, on the next one, where if you reworded it to say design guidelines and standards for specific areas of the community shall be implemented depending on existing and anticipated growth and enhanced community gateways and overlays or something, that could be the policy for billboards. You know, it addresses that. But that first one doesn't do us anything.
We can start.
Valdosta, where you know people are crossing the street to go to a concert on the lawn or eat their lunch, and a log truck is going 45 miles an hour down the street.
Which they're not supposed to be doing.
I don't know.
The way I might think of stating it is, I'd write something like, lower speed limits and lower design speeds shall be considered in
high pedestrian
yes.
traffic areas.
Don't you have to do a traffic study lowering the speed limits?
Yeah. Signalization in downtown
okay.
speed limits are 25.
But
you could also say enforce. Enforce it. You can design it on
and
if you
actively
want.
Enforce.
The speed limit through downtown right now is 25.
People don't go 25 in downtown.
If a log truck's coming through at 45.
Yeah, they're going 45.
Yeah.
They're running off the road. I mean, I don't want to drive 25 in downtown because I might get run down. Never mind trying to cross the street.
You might be doing something there, enforced. Yeah, I would use the phrase actively enforced.
But I think that the whole design thing where we're going to have pedestrian-centric areas, then we need to design them to be pedestrian friendly.
Mm-hmm.
And the, there are two things, there's speed limits and there's design speed, and you know, when lanes are narrower, people drive slower.
Well, I wrote that online, that, you know.
Always
I wrote that sentence already in my little comments. I
wider
said,
and faster isn't safer.
Yeah, wider and faster isn't safer.
But yeah, various features like vertical barrier, not barriers, vertical, what's the term?
Calming devices.
Just more sort of vertical things. it slows down traffic. And other, yeah.
I keep wanting to pull one of those little kids with a turtle out by the street and our, you know, make a drag racer.
Curves.
You know, stop.
Which is why I might think, in terms of not just lowering the speed limits on signs, but also employing road street design practices that lower the design speed.
You need these phrase traffic calming measures.
Right.
Right.
That's it.
Shall be utilized.
Yeah.
So
traffic calming measures.
Uh-huh.
Shall be utilized in.
Right.
Yeah, in what you said.
In areas with high pedestrian traffic.
Yeah.
So do we want a policy that talks about both, like speed limits shall be enforced and traffic calming measures shall be employed?
I would make them be separate things.
Separate
things. Speed limits shall be enforced. Traffic calming devices shall be employed in pedestrian design friendly areas. And you know, that's schools, you know, kids are walking to schools and in downtowns. And Hay Howard has the same problem. I mean, the main street in Hay Howard is 122. You know, it's got on-street parking and trucks zooming up and down the road. Like, oh, not good. You know, trying to go from the restaurant to the grocery store, you get killed.
So, one issue, speed limits. Speed limits shall be enforced, and another issue, traffic calming measures shall be employed, especially in areas with high pedestrian traffic.
What did you say? What high pedestrian traffic?
Maybe say in areas of traffic congestion and high pedestrian.
Pedestrian design
insider.
Is what I'm, you know. Pedestrian design, though, includes a sidewalk. You know, we have kids walking to school still not with a sidewalk, but we have a whole section about sidewalks, so I'm good with that.
So we could say traffic calming measures and pedestrian-friendly design shall be employed, especially in areas with traffic congestion and high pedestrian traffic.
It's an apple and an orange there.
It's a what?
I mean, the traffic calming measures in areas, it's not just pedestrians, but areas even of just high vehicle congestion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to calm the traffic there, I think is a good thing. Mm-hmm. But and also,
and then another one to say in areas of high pedestrian traffic or pedestrian design.
In other words, keep all the pedestrian thoughts together,
mm-hmm.
and then all the congestion. Roadway design for high congestion areas.
Sure, so two separate policies,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, so one will be pedestrian friendly design shall be employed in areas with high pedestrian traffic. Where exactly? It's not
where in two places where there's congestion and where there's pedestrian traffic. I mean, that those traffic calming devices have to be where you want people going slow in their car when someone's potentially crossing the street. You know, I can't tell you how many times I drive down Patterson Avenue, the light is flashing that somebody wants to cross, and the cars are just zooming by still. They're not.
Mm-hmm.
They're not stopping. I mean, and that's, How many people have killed on passing? A lot. Trying to cross the road. Some of them are doing it legally. They're legally crossing in the crosswalk and they're still being killed. Not good. We need you to muddle about that. Matt might be able to give you the right one.
Okay, well, what I've got so far is pedestrian-friendly design shall be employed in areas with high pedestrian traffic, and traffic calming measures shall be employed in areas with congestion and areas with high pedestrian traffic. Or areas with high pedestrian traffic.
Yeah.
So that's a start. and could be also in areas with speeding problems or safety problems.
Mm-hmm. Right, on page 53, in several of these issue statements, they make specific example references, mm-hmm. which somehow to me just seems awkward to do that.
Sure.
And this is a countywide plan.
Sure.
I would take, if it were me, I would take them out.
Yeah.
You want to give an example of one?
Well, I mean, like number 3 on page 53.
Yeah.
You know, it cites specific areas in Valdosta. And this really shouldn't be a Valdosta only thing. Mm-hmm.
In the issue.
And I would say.
And I'm just trying to think ahead because I think DCA folks will look at that and see those street names. Then expect to find projects to address those streets specifically later on. And it's going to tie our hands.
Right.
Get the examples out of that, we know where they don't work.
And that's
some crossing signals do not work, period.
Right. And there's going to be places other than just these where it's an issue. So we need to leave that open.
Yeah, the examples of local places aren't really necessary anyway. I mean, and that's the kind of thing that's addressed more in the community work program. At the bottom of page 53, there's another that uses 5 points as an example.
Well, yeah, number 3, number 4, and I saw the 5 points on number 8.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and I'll take those out. They don't really need to be there.
And even on page 54, number 13.
Bakery Road, okay.
And so where do you see that?
Sure.
Okay, well, and even in number 9, truck traffic in downtown.
Downtowns.
Okay, downtowns. Downtowns. Downtown
towns,
of Lake Park, downtown of, in the downtowns, all of the downtowns.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Sure.
Number 15, what is our ROW?
Right of way.
Yeah, that needs to spell
it
out.
Yeah, I'll spell that out.
I've got a question on page 54, number 12.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand what number the
single
car rail, the issue or the policy is at all.
Okay, the issue is, I know what the issue is. The issue is it would be nice if you could get from here to somewhere else where there's a train, or to take a train from, there used to be a train that went from.
Talking about passenger train.
From Quitman to Valdosta, from Hayhawer to Valdosta. Single car, there used to be a single car that went. There's pictures of it over in the museum.
Okay.
So if you could go from here to Jessup on the train, single car.
Passenger. Okay, because the policy is.
Doesn't talk about passenger. I know I said that too in my comments.
Okay.
It doesn't address that you're a passenger.
I don't know.
If it addresses passenger, I think it should be combined with number 11.
Right, that's what I was about to say.
And my comment on 823 was it needs to include movement of passengers in addition to goods. Moving passengers, not just goods.
So we'll strike issue number 12 and combine it with number 11, essentially.
I wouldn't get rid of the policy as long as you say passengers and goods. 823.
823.
Passengers and goods. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Passengers. So
does that sometimes you actually do see an engine carrying one car behind it of goods. You know, one coil car or something.
You know, some of the little short lines that are around here.
Yeah.
And I imagine they become sort of a nuisance on the main lines. Every big train trying to get through.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, and all of that has to do with the CSX and Norfolk and Southern scheduling and stuff. I mean, when you ever ride a train, you know that if you're not on time and you're on the sidetrack waiting for that freight train to go by.
Yeah.
But if we had a policy that talked about moving passengers, well, maybe something would ever happen. You know, if we don't have a policy to say we want to move passengers, I'll tell you, I'd love a million times. I'm even thinking that I would tolerate only having to drive to Madison to get on the train and then take it all the way to Jacksonville and then all the many hours longer, but the drive would be so much shorter and safer. Driving over to Jessup to get on the train over there and then drive home. You know, John hit deer one night driving home after he dropped me off. It's a long, dark drive.
To Madison
yeah. Is close now. So, you know, if they reopen that line, it would be awesome.
The Amtrak station in Madison is closed?
It's been closed since Katrina. They closed that line. The thing that went from Jacksonville to New Orleans, they, when Katrina took the bridge out, they closed that station. I mean, it's still there.
They're just now reopening that line.
I know they just had a test run of that line.
Tallahassee hasn't had passenger train service since
Katrina, yeah. So now we're talking about opening that up and we'd be able to get on to Madison. It would be so much better.
That'd be great. So, did you say I should combine those two issues, or are they good as the
11 and 12.
11 and 12.
And that's a goods.
Right.
You can have more than one policy under there. But
yeah, keep the policy.
Keep the policy.
Right.
Let's say passengers, people.
Mm-hmm. And should the issue just say lack of passenger rail service?
Yeah.
It doesn't really need to say those cities.
It doesn't even need to say to where, to anywhere. Just local, you can't get on the train here.
And maybe broaden it, passenger rail service to metropolitan hubs and other communities.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever they may be.
Whatever they may be.
Sure.
I can't say the number of five, but we all have. You drive to Atlanta in the morning, you're there. You ride home at night. Wouldn't it be nice to get on the train in the morning?
Yeah.
You know, have all those hours for working instead
Read a book?
Yeah. Something.
Get some work done?
Yeah.
Sure.
Page 55, item number 16, policies 27 and 29. They both seem to say the exact same thing. I think 29 could probably be removed because 27 says you would have the same thing. Also on page 55, and I'm moving into the community facilities and services section. It's on page 55 and page 56, items 9.1, 9.2, 9.6, and 9.8. I believe that they are word for word the same.
Yeah, they're the same one.
Uh-huh. However, I don't feel that those particular policy statements address the underlying issue.
Mm-hmm.
One thing might be to consider combining some of these statements. I know because we separate them out by city.
Mm-hmm.
Because Lake Park and Dasher they're different. They don't have those services right now. Well, it's a higher end Valdosta do. So I guess I can't justify them being separate because of that. But to me, those statements that are word for word the same don't address that underlying issue.
Mm-hmm.
Well, so in number five, ensure that wastewater processing is adequate to handle the increased capacity for economic development and industrial wastewater treatment. Okay. Do the other two policies here satisfy that? Ensure the provision for funding of infrastructure, community facilities, public services that support sufficient growth and development patterns. And maximize the use of existing infrastructure. Do those two policies, no, there needs to be a policy that says enforce or something. To make sure that industrial waste is handled correctly and doesn't make it into the water stream waste.
I that's all a good comment, but I think for some of these, I'm going to go back to issue number one for Lake Park and Dasher. Mm-hmm. Lack of water or lack of sewer availability, are they going to eventually run out of capacity for development? Are they going to have to look at actual sewer plant construction? You know, does that mean a joint authority? Does that mean going in with the county? What does that mean?
I think that was the thinking behind the issue.
But to me, the policy doesn't say that. It's all about land use.
So, right. Mm-hmm. So I think that would be one of those instances where I found the best policy.
I think we need a new policy written in there for several of those. And I think you can maybe look at some of those and tweak it. I mean, not right now.
Sure.
So, Corey, your problem is that it's not a land use thing, but it's a resource consumption issue.
It's a community facility.
It's a community facility, and it's not a land use.
It's not land.
I'm not going to disagree that land use doesn't play part of that, but there's more to it.
Probably would be a policy like feasibility of a sewer system in those areas shall be investigated.
Yeah, maybe something like that. Yeah. It's
well, or to that coordination with the county.
Yeah, in
conjunction with the county. You know, maybe they decide, well, we're not going to build our own. We're just going to.
You can do that.
These counties in camp.
Which, you know, for Lake Park is easy and convenient because the unincorporated areas that are built out urban-like are part of the county sewer system.
Right.
Lake Park would be very easy.
Dasher land use pattern is so spread. It would be hard.
But correspondingly, it may be longer before they have issues with their.
And I think these are more long-term issues. Definitely. But if we're going to put it in, we can put some long-term, forward-looking policy statement in it. We realize that this is an issue. We need to look at it. It's not something to look at maybe next year, but.
And Eric, if you were to look at the comp plan from the early 90s, the same issue was identified back then.
Oh, yeah.
And there'd be some language in there for that, too.
Oh, okay.
A lot of that stuff from the 90s got overlooked in the 06 plan.
Yeah. Okay, I'll look at that.
But it was identified back then. Mm-hmm. Okay. Lake Park was being encouraged to tie in. It wouldn't.
In 10, intergovernmental coordination, 10.1 and 10.4 say the same thing, except for 10.1 says it better, so 10.4 should go away.
Ooh, you say that again? I'm sorry, I was...
Page 57.
Near the bottom.
10.4 should go away.
10.4 should go away. 10.1 says the same thing, it says it better. Yeah. And then 10.2 has that same, it's the same sentence as we saw before in 519. The word
appreciated
needs to go away.
Yes. Okay. I had a comment on page 56, policy 911. Mm-hmm. Policy 911 does not go at all with the public library.
Correct.
Especially being accessible by foot and bike. Mm-hmm. 912 does. Mm-hmm.
Should we have an additional new policy specific to the library?
No.
Interesting that 9/11 should go away out of that section. Yeah. 9/12 needs to be the one.
Right? Yeah, 9/12, just one policy there. Yeah. Okay, good.
engaging stakeholders is not always effective when done at the end of page 57, the last thing on page 57. There are two policies, establish and coordinate regular meetings and establish better coordination, collaboration, communication with colleges. I think that there needs to be something about use a variety of methods to engage the community. A variety of methods to engage the community shall be used, including newspaper, radio, TV, social media, you know, a wide range. Not everybody, I just was at a meeting, not everybody has email. Some people still need the newspaper. Not everybody gets the newspaper. You can't just say, well, I put it in the legal organ. Because most people don't use legal organ nowadays. So we need to use a variety of the ways and really use them. We shall use them. We're not just going to use the legal organ.
If we were like trying to do a text survey, like a survey, we can use like text messaging, probably. Like when that county did this thing called Great Exchange, like Great with an A, exchange, it was on transportation. It actually got to a point where it trended on Facebook and Twitter nationally at one point. Definitely a good Google search.
And we have the county has the red alert thing, you know, they call up and leave a message.
Code red.
You know, and now we have a website, fancy website, so you can sign up and get more things. We should use that push mechanism so that people want to get notified about something, they can get a text, or they can get a voicemail about it, or they can get a something. We should use that. The city has a brand new website too, right? Where you just have to sign up and put your email in.
Click and fix it.
Yeah.
See, click fix.
Yeah. So, you know, to have people who maybe want to think of themselves as stakeholders but are always on the outside because I would have gone to that meeting but I didn't know. Okay, here's really ways that you can push the information that then there's no more I didn't know. Then it's really they just didn't come.
So we have a new policy, a wide range of methods should be used to engage the community, including newspaper, message boards, social media, email, direct mail, websites, phone, etc.
I don't know how many of those
you want to
say, but yes.
Or maybe no example.
Just say yeah.
Wide variety. You know, Curry really effectively used the billboards. I mean, every place you went around town, there was a billboard saying, transportation study, you couldn't go around town and not know.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Media sources, maybe?
Mm-hmm.
Media sources and methods.
Just not talking about this.
Yeah.
Wide range of methods and media sources should be used to engage the community.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Media sources.
Well, and then when, you know, the city and the county are upgrading their website and they say, we want to get this new feature, okay, well, now they have a policy that helps them to back up using that new feature to push stuff out.
Issues 3 and 4 kind of address the same issue.
Mm-hmm.
It should be kind of combined together. You need improved access and lack of transparency. And you have similar policies as well. And you have 10.8, 10.9 are the same for data.
Yeah, I would say issue number 4 is actually a non-issue. Or maybe it needs to be written.
Combined with
number 3.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
A lack of transparency, not of local requirements, of local governments.
Activity.
Yeah.
We could just say need improved transparency and access.
Yeah.
Right. And then you don't have to have 10.8 and 10.9, you just have one of them. And then it would be 10.3 point whatever the heck the number runs.
So if we keep, oh, I see that. Okay, right. So we keep, we have two policies under that issue, and, okay.
Well, then I have actually a suggestion for another policy under that. Mm-hmm. In 10.8, I wanted to add access to documents and decisions equitable transparency. That promotes transparency.
Yeah, okay, so can we word this issue with comments in a way that, oh, I see, not the issue with policies, sorry.
Policy.
Okay, develop regional leadership and local governance that promotes
transparency.
Transparency.
And then including
access
to documents and decisions, citizen engagement, and coordinated delivery of government services. You know, because we talked about that coordinated calendar thing, but I don't get. I'm not sure which calendar I'm going to find something on. Do I go to city or do I go to county? Is there a place? Okay, you got my comment about. Page 57, the item number 13, the community is a local meat processing plant with USDA certified personal on-site, so animals can be processed locally. This policy doesn't, it's not recreation. Processing animals is not recreation.
I'm sorry, that was a mistake.
It's not recreation. The policy needs to be investigate and explore, implement opportunities for farmers to have access to local USDA certified meat processing plant.
Got it. I see. That's in the email we sent you to. Thank you.
Yeah,
yes.
That's,
okay.
That was basically one case. Because we talked about that the last time. You gave the right language for that. Mm-hmm. Who knows if we could ever get that, but we need to explore.
Yeah. Part of promoting our local agriculture industry, and that's under our
And I think that John mailed in comments about adding agriculture in some of the places where we talk about our big industries.
Yeah.
Include agriculture as one of the named things that we talk about.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that we could adopt it when we all start. Mm-hmm.
Sorry, what was, did you say something? Okay. I think we're getting near the end of things, folks.
So more revisions, formatting, new numbering system.
Yes.
New sentence structure.
Batteries, language.
I'll send it out to you all as soon as I can. I see no reason why that shouldn't be tomorrow. I'll try to get it done by the end of the day tomorrow.
He's quite a lot.
It's good to get on these things quickly and. Aim for a quick turnaround, and then if you get a chance, please take one more look at it after I send it out. And
then just respond to you directly with further comments or suggestions.
Yeah, please do. Yeah, okay. And if you want, please do go over the opportunities and let me know if there are any more from those opportunities that should really be in the policies. And the next workshop, we'll switch gears and look at maps. And
I was wondering, skipping ahead, what are we going to, talk strictly future land use kind of stuff in terms of mapping character areas?
Yeah, the emphasis is going to be on that. I think typically we've looked at existing land use. Now, I know for Valdosta and for Lowndes County, there's a lot of territory to cover, and you all have your own GIS systems. So
Well, this is going to be a bit different from the smaller community comprehensive plans I have done here, where it's more like you just mark out the map of a small place. So I think essentially it's going to be whatever approach you want to take, but definitely
right,
we want to look at character areas.
Right, in 06 we abandoned feature land use categories and went strictly with character areas only.
Right.
Fully described the character area, the development strategy for each.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm assuming we would stick with that approach. I know some communities around the state use both.
Right.
Which is ambitious.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that I might offer is for the MPO that was up, the transportation plan that was updated last year, we did the future land use map with estimates of density and timelines for build out, as well as high level residential, commercial, industrial. We didn't get any more detail than that. That might be something to use as a reference, but I wouldn't necessarily use it as a place to start from.
Right.
It might be a reference point.
Yeah.
I would.
Especially
if you're talking about what development patterns might be, things like that. Now, not to, it may be things have changed. I mean, it's not that nothing in that is written in stone. But we have that already in GIS that it can be printed off easily and be a point of reference.
Well, part of it, I mean, the character areas that we currently have, the palette of character areas. I mean, they're very broad. There's a lot of overlap between them. I don't know. It's something we want to look at again. And if there's examples from other communities outside the area that have used some different choices there to look at.
I think I did send out an email reminding at least yourself and Jason to review the character
areas.
Yeah,
which we have. And I know in Valdosta, 5 years ago, 2011, we went through a painstaking review, city council district by city council district, on a whole atlas of maps that I had produced, and fine-tune where those character areas were located, and change boundaries accordingly. Valdosta enforces the zoning districts that are permitted in each character area, so we took a hard look at that and made a bunch of changes there too. But also doing similar type of things in Hayhira. I mean, it came very clear to me that when we came up with those broad categories, it was done on purpose because it was a county-wide listing of character areas.
Mm-hmm.
And when you get into the smaller communities, sometimes these broad and general character areas don't work so well.
Mm-hmm.
But I would hesitate adding a bunch on there just to accommodate each little town. That's going
well,
to be
and what
yeah.
about the unincorporated parts of the county where our character area is rural? I mean, we're
well, there's several of them out there. I mean, there's, you know, there's the bourbon area, which is a pretty big one, and then there's the ag forest one. But yeah, there may be room for some others.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of them overlap. I mean, you know, half of Hayhira is eaten up with, you know, rural designations.
Right.
Quite fit.
Well, but if the landowner wants their land to stay rural, they should have that option, shouldn't they?
Well, it should, but see, there's a difference between character area and zoning. I mean, the character area is just a broad description of an area and a strategy for an area. It's not regulatory at all.
But it guides future development.
But it does guide
future
development.
But if there's to
so
be redevelopment of it, right, then it guides what that ought to be. Yeah, but I mean, would you want a 40-acre farm to be maintained in perpetuity in downtown Valdosta?
Well, apparently somebody does right on Bemis Road, you know, just north of Blue Pool. There's a cotton field there.
Yeah, a big one, right?
Yeah.
And there's a story behind that property.
So, okay, so, you know, yes. So, yes. But, you know, on the other hand, I want development close into existing services. So, you know, if it's a choice between developing a cotton field on Bemis Knights Academy, and that one, you know, heck, I mean, for the one on Bemis Road, but the property owner is the one that's ultimately the holder of that decision.
Right, and so nothing's forcing the property owner to change, but if you put in the form of a character area or something else in future land use plans, a designation for that property on Bemis Road, so when, if it gets redeveloped, here's the guidelines. But it doesn't force it to actually happen. It's just, it's an if scenario.
So, and then that leaves the character area of Bemis Knights Academy to be rural where there's farms right. still out there.
Right. And if it's to be preserved that way for the foreseeable future, then that's how it should be designated. And there was language like that from years ago too, in the protection of the rural service area.
Well, and I think that where the urban service areas for the county is pretty clear. You know, we spent a lot of time building out infrastructure all the way out to the Pine Grove School, you know.
Right.
So.
And down Whitewater Road.
And Flagstone Road.
All right, so for June 6th, you'll send us some materials, maps, and things to look at?
I will, yeah.
Did we ever get the
Absolutely.
Issue of the current character area mapping straight?
Because
before, there was some discussion of mapping and people thinking those were the original 2006 maps as opposed to the 2011. The 2011 version of the character area map is in Valor right now.
Okay.
It has been since 2011.
I will make sure
the,
that the most...
Yeah, and the original one is in there too, but it's under a different file name.
And 2011 is the most recent?
Yeah, it says character area is 2011.
That's
the
latest
name of the shape file. That's
okay.
the latest and greatest.
I'll make absolutely sure.
As amended, we've actually amended a couple parcels in Valdosta. But it should be reflected in that same shape file, which is character area is 2011.
And it's in the Valor system.
Because we use it all the time.
Right.
And make sure we're using that one, not the 06 one.
Right. Okay, I'll make sure. I hadn't really gotten to the land use maps. We've had a little cut out of issues and policies and all that.
Right.
But yeah, I'll be bombarding you all with plenty of information in the next few weeks. But certainly, if you want to make any changes to your palette of character areas, let me know. I think that would be. That's the main thing for right now. Other than that,
thank you, sir.
Roll on 6 days.
Thank you. Thank you.